people tested the Lord, and because they put the Lord and approved by saying, is the Lord amongst us. Now, brothers, listen carefully how many times I said, and Moses said to me, where is the Lord? Where is he said, why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the proof? Why do you put the Lord to the test? And then the Bible says, because of this, there's Samaria, because they tested the Lord, and they put the Lord to the test, okay? Listen to what happened on the second time this happened. Numbers chapter 20, verse 3. Now, this incident was different, because the people are asking for different things. And I think that this was at the end, before they came to the promised land. In this incident, it says, and the people contended with Moses and said, would that we had died when our brethren died before the Lord. Why have you brought us of the Lord into the wilderness, that we should die here, both us and our cattle? And why have you made us camp out of Egypt to bring us to this evil place? It's no place for grain, or figs, or vines, or pomegranates, and there is no water to drink. This time they're not just asking for water, they're asking for other stuff. So Moses went to the tent and cried to the Lord with his brother Aaron, and the Lord said to Moses, take the rod and assemble that congregation. You and Aaron, speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will give out its water. You shall bring water out of the rock for them, so you shall give drink to the congregation to their cattle. And Moses did this, he gathered the people, but look at what he says here to the people. Remember first time what he said, why do you put the Lord to the test? Listen now. He says here, hear now you rebels, shall we bring forth water for you out of the swamp? See the difference? It's a very big difference than saying, why do you put the Lord to the test? And then here saying, shall we bring you water out of the swamp? Who brings the water out of the rock? Is it Moses? Or is it the Lord? So there's a big difference here. And then he did this. He lifted up his hand and struck the rock in his rod twice. Water came out, and the congregation drank and their cattle. And the Lord said to Moses, because you did not believe in me to sanctify me in the eyes of the people of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land I give them. That was the reason why they were not allowed to live. So I think that it's a big deal. I didn't know how much man or how bad Moses' mistake was until I figured out the difference between the first time and the second time. Because the second time Moses is taking credit for bringing water under the rock. He's taking some of the Lord's glory. That's a very big mistake. The Lord will not allow that. He probably forgot something in that. It's not him. Now you can see why it's called the Malachi Rock. He forgot, maybe at the end, that it's not him. These are not his people. That's why we read the following in Deuteronomy 34 because of that mistake. And that's the last chapter of Deuteronomy. Or are you going to read it in church, the site? Or should I read it now? They usually say the same thing. They usually say, because we're going to Mount Hill because Moses saw the promised land. Because Moses was buried here. Because of Deuteronomy 34. So this is all correct, yes, but if Moses did not do this mistake, Father, we would not be going here anyway. We would be going to a place where Moses crossed with the Israelites into the promised land. Okay? Because of these incidents, he wasn't allowed to go. And in Deuteronomy 34, we read the following. And Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah. I told you Pisgah is the highest peak you're going to. I showed it to you the diagram. And the Lord showed him all the land from Gilead as far as Dan, all of Naphtali, the land of Ephraim, and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev, and the plains that is the valley of Jericho, the city of Ponzius, as far as Zoar. And the Lord said to him, this is the land of which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. He buried, and the Lord buried him in the valley of the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor. But no one knows the place of his burial to this day. Moses was 150 years old when he died, and his eyes were not dim, nor his natural force abated. And the people of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the days of the weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. And Joshua the son of Nun was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands upon him. So the people of Israel obeyed him, and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. And there has not risen a prophet since Israel like Moses, in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Unlike him, for all the signs and wonders which the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh and all the servants and all his servants and all his land. And for all the mighty power and all the great and terrible deeds which Moses brought in the sight of all Israel. So still the Bible says, he was a great man. In spite of that mistake, yes, there was consequence that he was not allowed to enter the promised land. But he did finish well, because as we just read, he laid his hands on Joshua in front of the people. And the Lord gave Joshua wisdom, and he said, go and finish the job for me. Who would do that? Usually people are bitter. He worked in a company for 40 years, and then you give it up for somebody else, for a new person, a young person. He's just beginning. We don't really want him to succeed. This is the human nature. We want him to fail so that people say, you know, when the former president was here, it was better. He was the reason why we were succeeding. But Moses did not do that. And although he did not enter the promised land here, did he eventually enter the promised land? Yes, Father. He said yes. Where? New Jerusalem in heaven, right?
Yes.
But no, I'm talking literally about that Jerusalem. Did he go there?
No.
How about when he appeared with Jesus and Elijah on the Mount of Transfiguration? So maybe after hundreds of years, he finally entered the promised land from another way back there. How do we know that this is the right location? It fits the criteria that we talked about at Bethany. The Bible scripture, it fits the location that the Bible speaks about. And then the account of the early pilgrims, did they mention the place? Yes, it fits the account of the early pilgrims. Very famous pilgrim by the name of Egeria, a lady. Look at how hard it is down here. This road was not here when she visited Mount Nebo 1500 years ago, and she climbed all of this, that beautiful Spanish lady, Egeria, and she wrote about it. She said it was so hard to climb up to Mount Nebo when we entered Arabia. By the way, this is Arabia in the Bible time. This is part of Arabia. Not Saudi Arabia, it's not just Arabia that was in Jesus' time and Paul's time. This was part of Arabia. And she said it was hard to climb to Mount Nebo. There's Mount Nebo up here. But she did it, and she found structure there that was from the 4th century, even built on top of an earlier structure, like a small chapel, small monastery. And then after that, the small monastery was built into a basilica, and it was destructed by an earthquake, and then rebuilt again and expanded in the 6th century. I will tell you more about what we found here, and what the Franciscan monks did after coming here in 1933, and buying the land from the local tribe, because all the land in Jordan, like I mentioned before, is owned by the locals, even here. And they came here, the Franciscan monks from Jerusalem, because they heard rumors that local people who live here, this side, they call this peak Jabal Musa. Jabal in Arabic is mountain. And Musa, Moses. So So they came to look where is this Jebel person, and they found it. They bought the land and they started the excavation, and they uncovered the beautiful church and the mosaics underneath that we see today. So all the descriptions fit here to this site. Now that's how we know that this site will be. Of course, when it was rediscovered, there was baptism rediscovered, there was mosaic quartz. And again, this is the valley that we went down from to Bethany, and behind it is Hamulite, is Amman, the capital, and here we are in Moabite. Enough talking, let's eat first. We are 5 minutes away. Sorry? We were going to eat about in a restaurant 5 minutes away from